Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner. I am available for code reviews and on-site training. Now, in this episode, I'm going to pick up on that same project that I originally got cleaned up from C++ 98 code in my C++ 98 code restoration video, and then in a very recent episode moved from C++ 98 to C++ 11. Now, just a quick reminder that a lot of the transformations that I did manually in the C++ 11 migration, I could have done automatically with Clang tidies modernized, but certainly not all of them. And a good example of that would be this in place function that I chose to add to clean up some other code. So be aware that there are tools for these things. Use Clang tidies modernized features. You can apply automated transformations on your code, but we're going to go ahead and talk through the things that we would do as we move this code from C++ 11 to C++ 14. This episode of C++ Weekly is sponsored by JetBrains. Every year, JetBrains runs a survey to discover the latest trends in the developer ecosystem. In 2023, they collected over 34,000 responses from software developers worldwide, 2,627 of whom marked C++ as one of their top three primary languages. What insights did they glean from it? C++ 20 is the base dialect. Python is the number one companion to C++. The C++ toolset has remained stable in recent years, and Clang-based tools are growing in adoption. Curious for more? Check out the link in the video description. Now, C++ attributes were added in C++ 11, and it's probably a good idea for us to keep this reference up to see which attributes we might want to add as we move along. So we've got no return and carries dependency. Those don't have any bearing on this code. And sorry for the quick change from dark to white. I don't have the correct thing set up here to have the dark mode for CVP reference at the moment. And deprecated is added in C++ 14. So we don't get to the really interesting things until we get to no discard and maybe unused in C++ 17. So that's not going to help us out a whole lot at the moment. The other thing that we want to pay attention to is what libraries are available to us. And we're going to be moving from C++ 11 to 14, and I have been hand-rolling my own unit test kind of framework thing here, and I'm very excited about the possibility of successfully moving to catch 2. Now let's be clear. So catch 2 says that it requires 14 or 17, and we are going to see which of the actual requirements it has for what we want to do. It looks like C++ 14, 17, and later. So we could have gone back to an old branch to get C++ 11 support, but I knew that I was going to be doing this migration, and I know there's other testing frameworks out there, but I think we should be pretty good going ahead and rolling in catch now. Now, this project that I have has CPM integrated, and I have done other episodes on this, and this is using my own personal C++ starter project that you can use as a template project on GitHub. And I'm going to go ahead and enable catch 2 with main. So I want it to provide main for me. Now, this was hard fixed at 3.3.2. And we're currently at 3.5.2, which was only released 4 hours ago. Let's go ahead and see if this builds with our settings of C++ 14. And I was setting that globally for my project and dependencies up here. Now, we could make lots of arguments about how this CXX standard is set, but this seems to work for me. I have if not defined, because someone else might be consuming my library and choosing to set a different standard, and otherwise I want to set the standard. Now, I'm going to kind of, in a way, force this on my dependencies, because you can get ODR violations if you have your different libraries compiled in different C++ standards. And it comes down to things like multiple destructors that are constexpr and non-constexpr added to standard library types in C++ 20, for example. All right, that looks like that was good. Let's go ahead and continue. So my template project already comes with a bunch of catch boilerplate stuff in here, which I disabled to get it compiling in the C++ 98 and 11 modes. So we're going to go ahead and use these things, and I'm going to re-uncomment them. All right, so I have three test targets in total. One is the normal test library that doesn't expect to be constexpr. The other one is a constexpr-enabled test suite that compiles and runs both at compile time constexpr check and runtime to make sure that we get the same behavior and the same test running in both situations. So this is an infix math expression evaluator that started from a college project that I had in 1997, and I've been modernizing it and upgrading it and simplifying it and cleaning up all kinds of code if you've been following along on this journey. All right. Took a second for my IDE to catch up with the reality here. Okay, so we should now be able to just hit play on one of these and run or debug that particular test case. This is a very handy feature of having an IDE with unit testing support built in. And there we go, it's all test passed. It doesn't by default show me the test cases in here, but it worked. And I can also tell it to run all of the C-test known test. And that'll probably actually fail because it'll fail to compile the constexpr test file. Now, we have an interesting phenomenon going here because these are compile time tests. If I do something that is not going to work, I get an immediate notification in my IDE that this code can't compile. So we're going to have very fast feedback on our constexpr enabled test here. And we're just making sure some sanity test that rational number does in fact work at compile time. And we're going to probably also start to see that we're not very thrilled with having to type all of these things over and over again. Now, we're also going to end up kind of hard coding in some behavior here that we might not necessarily prefer, but I'm going to add a half to a quarter. And the way the code currently is written, it's going to add 4/8 to 2/8, and we're going to get 6/8 instead of 3/4. So if at some point we come in here and decide to automatically add the ability for it to simplify our rational numbers, then we're going to have to change our test suite. Okay, I think we're doing pretty good here. Let's just go ahead and run all of these tests, make sure everything build, compile, and execute in both compile time and runtime modes. Okay, that is getting somewhere. This is just the very surface level for adding C++ 14 supports. So let's go back and see if there's anything else that we would want to do. Now, I generally call C++ 14 a bug fix to C++ 11. And it's because it gives us things like auto return type deduction and cleans up some of our constexpr, but not by far all of the constexpr things that we might do. So these are all, you know, pretty straightforward. If I wanted to, I could use auto return type deduction here, but then I would have to specify that I am returning a rational number. And I don't really think there's much to gain from that. So I'm going to go ahead and leave this as this. Now, I could use trailing return types here, but I also could have done that in C++ 11. And I think this is a matter of taste and consistency in your project. But let's go ahead and do that here. So I'm going to go ahead and enable the trailing return type rules in my Clang tidy configuration. As you can see here, I've enabled everything, but then I've gone through and I've disabled Absil, Altera, Android, Fuchsia, Google LLVM, and Zircon specific things. And then I clean up a few of these other things because sometimes the use after return check is incorrect. I often want to use const params, so I'm going to disagree with that. And we'll see how quickly we get feedback from our IDE here. There we go. And you'll see why a little bit later I'm choosing to do this. All right, still not a whole lot to do in main here. Oh, fine. Use trailing return types for main as well. And now we can actually make this function constexpr. And you might think that my desire to make all the things constexpr like I am seems a little bit silly, but we are actually going somewhere with this. And you're just going to have to trust me at the moment. I have the foresight of knowing what is possible in future versions of C++. Now, I did promise before that I can use now the fact that C++ 14's in place back automatically returns a reference to the thing that was added. That simplifies that code a little bit. Okay, so these three things, is number, is operator, and is white space, can all be constexpr. And I have the question of whether or not I just want to move them entirely inside of the string tokenizer CPP, because does the outside world care about this? This is something that I mentioned in the previous episode. I don't know if the outside world cares or not about the is number, is operator, and is white space, my view of the world of the tokenizer. I don't think they do. I'm inclined to simply remove these from the header file entirely and declare them just in here. But on the other hand, if I ever need to use them outside of this context, I might end up accidentally duplicating code. So I think what I'm going to ultimately do is make them free functions, perhaps. Not statics for all of these. Now, this gives the advantage that anyone using this code has this incredibly short function definition that is easy to inline, and they don't have to branch out to my library function, and they can use it at compile time. I think it's probably a win-win here. But we can see some of the failings of our tooling in some cases where it is telling me that is number is not used. All calls the function is number are unreachable. I don't know what that means. I'm clearly using it right here. But let's go ahead and I think we're going to start adding some namespaces in a moment as well. But let's take a look at this code. Tokenizer is now becoming fairly simple, which is good. It becomes a reference after C++ 2014, not in C++ 2014. Am I ever going to get this bit of code right? So this error from Clang tidy is wrong, and it's been wrong for a while. It says constness of to return prevents automatic move. Well, that's technically true if we weren't getting return value optimization, but we are getting return value optimization in this case. So we don't actually care that it would break an automatic move because we're getting return value optimization, which is in fact better. But I can silence the warning and write code that has less question at all if I just do this, return the object that I am creating in the return statement. It seemed to have introduced a bug. You all probably saw this. Okay, all the tests are passing again. So I think we're just about done here with our move to C++ 14. There's not a whole lot revolutionary happening, but a little bit going on. As you can see, our code is getting just a little bit smaller with each release. Okay, let's go ahead and wrap this episode up. Thank you for watching, and we will check out the move to C++ 17 in the next episode on this series.